The accident at Chernobyl power station in the Ukraine was the worst accident in the history of nuclear power, and it raised an immediate question in the minds of the British public. Could Chernobyl happen here? The Russians have since provided detailed information about the events at Chernobyl to an international conference in Vienna. As a result, it can be stated categorically that an accident similar to that one could not happen in a British nuclear power station. The explanation of why Chernobyl couldn't happen here is technical and complex. The reactor which failed had a number of design flaws. Two of fundamental importance are known as positive void coefficient and positive power coefficient. Basically, it comes down to the fact that a reactor of the Chernobyl design simply wouldn't have been allowed to operate in Britain. Its basic design faults meant that it couldn't have met our safety requirements. In fact, its design had been looked at by British experts over 10 years previously and rejected on safety grounds. But let's look at what exactly happened at Chernobyl on April 26, 1986. The lead-up to the explosion actually started 24 hours earlier. The sequence of events started when the Russians began to shut down their reactor in preparation for an experiment, a test which was ironically aimed at improving the overall safety of the reactor. The idea was to disconnect one of the turbines from the reactor and find out if it was possible to use the energy from it as it slowed down to power some pumps which were part of the reactor's emergency cooling system. The Russians, of course, had been operating this type of reactor, known as an RBMK-1000, for some 20 years. In their official report, they admit that there were significant violations in the operating rules for the power station on this occasion. But in Vienna, they also acknowledged it had basic design faults. In their discussions with international experts, the Russians confirmed that their operators placed the reactor in an unstable condition and that the design placed too much responsibility on the operator's shoulders. So let's look at what happened in greater detail. The experiment which the Russians hoped to carry out should have been no more than a one-off, tried just once as the reactor shut down and lasting about 45 seconds. But in case it didn't work first time, it was decided to keep the reactor working at a reduced level. The operators planned to reduce the level from 3,200 megawatts to around 700 megawatts and keep it there so that they could repeat the experiment if necessary. Unfortunately, the operator in charge failed to set the controller, the thermostat if you like, at 700 and the level dropped to 30. This set the scene for disaster. It's forbidden to operate an RBMK at lower than 700 megawatts because the design limitations make the reactor unstable and potentially dangerous at a lower power level. Determined to press ahead with their experiment, the men in the control room sought to bring the reactor back up to power again, but it was very difficult. They got the heat output back up to 200, but couldn't get it higher. Even to get that far, they had to switch off vital safety systems and deliberately withdraw many of the control rods. Control rods are designed to descend automatically into the reactor core to shut down the nuclear reaction in the event of a fault developing. Unfortunately, prior to the accident, the operators at Chernobyl withdrew too many rods, and they withdrew them too far, in fact, beyond the design limits. Unlike in British reactors, they were unable to insert them again fast enough when things started to go wildly wrong. The RBMK-1000 was not a reactor designed to cope automatically with operator error, as is the case with CEGB reactors. The Mark 1000 was a development of the very first Russian nuclear power reactor, which started operating at Obninsk as long ago as 1954. Nothing like it exists outside the Soviet Union. In fact, for that very reason, one of Russia's top nuclear scientists, academician Valery Legasov, has since stated publicly that an accident like the one which happened at Chernobyl would not be possible at any other reactor in the world. The reactor had two fundamental design flaws, and these were of vital importance that day, namely what physicists call a positive void coefficient and a positive power coefficient. An RBMK 1000 produces steam for its turbines by boiling water actually in the reactor using heat from the fuel elements. The same water circuit also cools the reactor. The water is pumped under pressure around 1,661 tubes made of an alloy of the metal zirconium, situated in the graphite core. In any water reactor, the amount of steam affects the tempo of the nuclear reaction. In the RBMK, an increase in steam increases the tempo, which in turn leads to more steam. Under normal operating conditions, this can be coped with by complex control systems. But at low power, and 200 megawatts was low power, the second phenomenon, the positive power coefficient, can occur. That's to say, more steam leads to more power, more steam, more power, and so on. In fact, a runaway situation. Without enough control rods in place, without any effective automatic shutdown systems operating, the Chernobyl reactor went on surging with power. Some of the uranium fuel disintegrated. Steam explosions occurred, bursting open the zirconium tubes. The flimsy structure around the graphite core couldn't contain the build-up in pressure, and the reactor literally blew its top. It didn't explode like an atom bomb. It's physically impossible for any reactor to do that. But the energy created was enough to throw a 1,000-ton concrete slab above the reactor to one side. Several fires broke out. The rest is history. The Russians have been remarkably frank about what happened at Chernobyl, admitting at the Vienna conference that the design of the RBMK 1000 placed too much responsibility on the operator's shoulders. They shut down 11 similar reactors for major modifications. The plain fact is that if the RBMK design had been right in the first place, the accident wouldn't, indeed couldn't, have happened. And it certainly couldn't have happened in Britain. Why not? Quite apart from the fact that the two types of CEGB reactor generating electricity in Britain, the Magnox and AGR, are gas-cooled, and it is physically impossible for a positive void coefficient to occur in them, our designs are based on safety in depth. It's the emphasis given to built-in safety from the earliest design stage which makes the CEGB confident that an accident on the scale of Chernobyl wouldn't happen here. The reactors are designed to cope with human error. Each design allows rapid detection of anything abnormal and emergency shutdown and removal of heat if any abnormality should occur. Safety systems are duplicated and in some cases triplicated and designed to fail safe so that if a fault occurs, the reactor is shut down automatically, quickly and safely. One of the design faults of the Chernobyl reactor was that it appears to have been comparatively easy to isolate or disconnect the reactor from its safety systems. In Britain's nuclear power stations, there are a series of barriers to prevent this happening, either through deliberate action or mistake. They include mechanical and electrical interlocks, alarm systems, and a multiplicity of safety systems. For a start, to get access to safety equipment, you have to have the right key. To get to that key, formal documentation is needed, written permission for whatever you want to do. Often, to get to one key, you have to use another key or unlock a padlock. And there is strict security and strict checks. And if anything untoward were to happen, a warning would come up in the control room and other safety systems would shut the reactor down. If a test or a change in normal operating procedure is required on a UK reactor, a detailed written plan has to be submitted, either to a group of expert engineers drawn from four separate departments within the CEGB, or to the power station's Nuclear Safety Committee, which is made up from representatives of the whole nuclear industry and a number of independent assessors from outside, or to one of its appointed subcommittees. Finally, it has to receive a seal of approval from the Nuclear Installations Inspectorate, an independent branch of the government's Health and Safety Executive. The NII is the watchdog for the generation of nuclear power in Britain, from the initial design of the reactor, through its construction period, and throughout its day-to-day operation. It has roving inspectors who can and do descend suddenly, and it has the power to close down a station if necessary or restrict its operations. After Chernobyl, people naturally wonder how well-trained are the CEGB's nuclear power station operators. Well, in Britain, to become any kind of reactor operator, much less a man in charge, you have to be educated to degree standard, have worked in the CEGB for several years, some of that time in power stations, and have undergone a year or more of stringent training specifically for nuclear reactors. The course begins with 4 weeks of theoretical work in lecture rooms, followed by alternate periods of training at nuclear power stations and in the Nuclear Power Training Centre at Oldbury in Gloucestershire. The work at Oldbury includes repeated sessions on simulators, computerized replicas of the various control desks in nuclear power stations, on which it's possible to simulate faults and accident situations and then rehearse operators in their corrective actions. The importance of these simulators is fully recognized by the International Atomic Energy Community. The Russians, since Chernobyl, have confirmed their importance. At every stage in a British reactor operator's training, he has to undergo a formal assessment. The results of this assessment are reported to the manager of his nuclear power station, the man with overall responsibility for the safety of the station and its reactors. It's the manager who finally decides whether the operator has reached the required high standard or not. And after his initial training, each operator returns to Oldbury for revision courses. The people most at risk from operations of a nuclear power station, of course, are those who work close to the reactors. So how do our British workers feel about their safety in the light of what happened at Chernobyl?
I find it somewhat hard to believe some of the things that we've heard about happening at Chernobyl. The more we hear about it, the more we disbelieve what they've actually managed to do, been able to do. We are unable to short-circuit our safety system. It's just not possible. If we attempted to, our reactors would shut down, they would trip automatically.
Well, Chernobyl hasn't changed my opinion at all. I was quite happy before Chernobyl, as I am now. Our safety standards are very high, and we've got many backup systems, and I feel there's no problem at all.
I feel very safe working in the reactor, and the wife, the children who are very near the reactor, feels very safe because I put them in the picture of what is happening down here, and the workmen down here are very self-conscious and very safety-wise.
Absolutely no fears at all, none whatsoever. And I live within about 8 miles of the place. My family there, two girls, no fears for them at all either.
Britain needs nuclear power, but one thing is certain, nobody in the nuclear industry is complacent. All procedures are being examined as part of a continuing process. The Russian operators made inexcusable mistakes on that fateful night. But in spite of these, had they not been operating a reactor that had both a positive void and a positive power coefficient, there would not have been an accident. Conditions like those which arose at Chernobyl are totally inapplicable to all British reactors, either operating now or being considered for the future. And despite Chernobyl, the CEGB remains confident that nuclear power is among the safest of all industrial technologies.